Thank you, Jen. And I want to thank Book Soup for having me here, and also C-SPAN for being here. And also I want to thank my publisher, Public Affairs Books, and all of my friends and relatives and everyone who has turned out here. It's very nice of you to come. So I've been given all sorts of conflicting advice about what I should say or do or how this is supposed to work, and you know, how many times I should try to plug my own book. But I think rather than do all that, I'll just sort of, I'd like to leave as much time as we can for question and answer or discussion, but I'll sort of start by making a few main points or giving you a little background on how this all came about. Basically, as the title implies, it's about several different things. Actually, my publisher came up with the title. It's sort of a pun. Obviously, JFK and Nixon are movies that were made by Oliver Stone, as well as being presidents of the United States. And the me refers to me. So I didn't actually know JFK or Nixon. I wish I had, but I did know Oliver Stone. And I'm not going to say I wish I hadn't. I'll say that it was a mixed blessing, but I'm glad I did. But it's a book about Washington and Hollywood, and it's unusual in the sense that, I mean, there are a number of people who have made that journey, but not that many who have worked in both places, and I have done both, so it kind of, you know, it's kind of a perspective on the two and how they intersect in different ways. And to sort of make a long story short, I started by working with Senator John Kerry on the Hill. I was always interested in politics, and I wanted to work for a Democratic senator, and I went to law school, and I tried practicing law for a few years, and that didn't really excite me. And so I moved to Washington from California, and I was lucky enough to get a job with Senator Kerry in 1985. He had just been elected. And as of now, as of just the last couple of days, the book is even timelier because, of course, Al Gore has dropped out of the race and Kerry is probably the leading candidate for president on the Democratic side. And I think he'll probably win, and I think he'll make a great president. But I worked for him for about 3 or 4 years. I was a speechwriter and a legislative assistant. And one of the things I've found, I mean, in life is sort of everybody is a critic. And there's certain things that everybody thinks they know all about. And one of them is politics. Another one is movies. And now I'm finding out another one is books. And everybody sort of, you know, has their own opinion. But what I found, you know, when I went to Capitol Hill is there are many levels, many layers of politics that I wasn't aware of, and a lot of things that I had to learn, which was very interesting and stimulating experience to do. And Kerry was a new senator. He had been head of the Vietnam Veterans Against the War. He'd served in Vietnam. He was already kind of nationally known, and his initials are JFK, and he sort of has that, you know, rugged presidential Massachusetts Democrat kind of look that, you know, I mean, he just is kind of a natural, and he's a very good speaker, but I sort of learned how to write speeches for him by doing it, and learned about politics by being there. And one of the issues that I was assigned to work on was Vietnam veterans issues, and this was at a time when veterans were beginning to get more recognition, and that was actually how I first met Oliver Stone, was when he made Platoon. Carrie and I met with him in about 1987 at the Vietnam Veterans of America convention. Carrie was honored as Legislator of the Year, and Stone was being honored for Platoon. And so we met him, and I remember he was making Wall Street at that time, and he had just sort of become known through Platoon. That was his big breakthrough, and I think that was a great film. And so we talked about that, and at that time I had no idea, you know, whatsoever that I would ever end up in Hollywood, let alone working for Oliver Stone, but I did meet him, and so I worked for him for several years, and then basically he had been the lieutenant governor for Mike Dukakis, and in Massachusetts, and so we were very involved in that campaign. And then when Dukakis lost, I decided to take some time out, and I went to Stanford for an academic year. I'd gotten very interested in foreign policy issues, and I got a fellowship, and I was studying there. But I also had this sort of strange obsession in the back of my mind with the JFK assassination. I guess what brought it to the fore was that right at that same point in time, this is end of 88, was the 25th anniversary of Kennedy's assassination. So there were a number, I remember seeing a TV special that Jack Anderson did about it, about the conspiracy theories, and there were some books that came out, and I had always sort of been vaguely aware of this and always been interested, but never really pursued it. But, you know, I had this time out, and I started reading. I bought some of these books and started reading them. It turned out Stone had bought some of the same books, and one of them, which was Jim Garrison's book, ended up being the basis for JFK. One of the things that I found out, which I think most people don't know, is that there are two official versions of the JFK assassination. One is the Warren Commission, which most people know about, which says that Lee Harvey Oswald, acting alone, shot Kennedy and that he was a lone nut. But then Congress reinvestigated the assassination in the late 70s due to all the questions that had arisen, and the fact that it had come out that the CIA had plotted with the mafia to try to kill Castro. So they created what was called the House Committee on Assassinations, and they studied the Kennedy assassination, and they came to the conclusion that there was a conspiracy and that it involved the mafia. And so you have two conflicting official versions. And then that was never followed up. They sealed their files they had 850 boxes of files. They sealed them for 50 years. And, you know, nobody could get at them. And this Warren Commission had sealed their files for 75 years. So, you know, to me, I just thought, there's something wrong with this picture. First of all, they can't both be right. And, you know, how can something of this magnitude how can we not have the answer? This was, you know, this is one of the major events of this century. And so what I concluded after reading a number of the books was that basically there were more theories than facts, and we just needed more facts. And then what happened was, I went back to Washington on another fellowship, and I went to work for Lee Hamilton, who was then chairman of the Foreign Affairs Committee in the House, and is now, has just again, just within the last few days, has become co-chairman of the commission to investigate the 9/11 terrorist incidents. And he is a very upstanding, or was, I mean, he's no longer in Congress, but respected member of Congress, and had been chairman of the Intelligence Committee and the Iran-Contra Committee. And he asked me to look into the whole problem of government secrecy and what we could do about it. And he felt that way too many documents are classified, too many security clearances, too much secrecy, and that, you know, we should have more openness in government. And so I started researching it, and it was clear that that was true. I mean, just the other day, there was an article in the paper that said that the CIA is still refusing to release its budget from 1947 and 1948. So, I mean, you know, if you can believe that, you know, it's just, it's amazing, you know, the level of secrecy. And, of course, it's only gotten worse under the current Bush administration. They have a fetish for secrecy. But I began to realize, I put two and two together in my mind, and I researched it and found out that we could, just by passing a bill in the House, we could release the files of the House committee. And so that, so I persuaded Hamilton that we should do that. And this was before the movie JFK. This was before, you know, it had even, you know, been shot, or even, you know, anybody had heard of it. And so, but then I did hear about it, and I wrote a letter to Oliver, to Stone, through a mutual friend, and sent him a book. I had this idea that Hollywood directors, you know, probably knew nothing about anything, and, you know, certainly not about politics. And so I sent him what I thought was the best book on the subject, and he wrote me back a nice letter. And so, so to make a long story short, once we couldn't get anywhere with the bill. It was like just a taboo subject. Nobody wanted to touch it. But then all of a sudden, when the film was released, Congress was flooded with mail, and Hamilton was out front, you know, and we got so much support from the public for the bill that it actually was widened in scope and to include all government agencies. And we were able to get it passed, and we got it signed by the first Bush just a week before the election. And believe it or not, about 3 or 4 million pages of documents have actually been released this in the last almost 10 years since we passed the bill. And now a lot still have been withheld or redacted, which means blacked out. And of course, probably the most interesting ones are still, you know, classified. But still, it was a major accomplishment, and it set a precedent for other areas of government. And so Stone felt good about that. And so he offered me a job. And I thought, you know, what the hell? I'll go out to Hollywood. You know, it'll be an adventure. I'll stay a year or two. How bad can it be? And, you know, at least I'll get some good stories out of it. And so I came out. I didn't really know what I was doing. I didn't know what my title would be. And at first he wanted me to sort of do law and business stuff for him, which is not at all what I wanted to do. And I didn't really know what a producer was. But then as I sort of saw, you know, what was going on around there, at that time he had gone through this tremendous furor over JFK, which the likes of which had never been seen before, I think, for any movie. And then he made a film called Heaven and Earth about Vietnam, which probably very few people ever saw, but was a pretty good movie. And then he did Natural Born Killers, which was, you know, very controversial again. And so I came to work for him sort of just as he was finishing up editing those two movies. And this was about August of 93, so it's been almost 10 years now. And so that I quickly realized that the thing to be was a producer, at least for me, because, you know, there's all different kinds of producers. It can mean anything. But in my case, it meant sort of a creative producer, somebody who comes up with an idea, you know, finds a writer to write up a treatment, which is a few page summary of the idea or the story. And then, you know, hopefully, you know, is able to persuade Stone or somebody, some studio to hire a screenwriter and write it, and then hopefully it gets made. And when I say Hollywood hell in the title, it's sort of a joking reference to a term that is often used, which is development hell, which is the period between when the project starts and when, if ever, it actually gets made. And that can be years. And scripts get written and rewritten, and, you know, one writer after another. And so it's a crazy process. But one of the good things about being somebody like Oliver Stone is you have the power, you know, to do it your way. You don't have to play by the studio rules. Studios are very cautious, and they only want to make a movie, you know, that's basically a copy of something else that's already been successful. And, you know, to hire an A-list actor and the writer and have it, you know, some movies have like 10 producers on them and 15 writers, and not all of them are credited. But, you know, it's just, it's a crazy system. I have a sort of rule of thumb that there's an inverse relationship between the amount of money that's spent on a film and how good it is. In other words, you know, a $200 million movie is going to be only 1% as good as a $2 million movie, because, you know, independent movies are made by one person with their own vision, whereas, you know, these big movies are made by formulas, and it just seems to work that way. But anyway, I also, the reason I want to work with Stone is because he seemed to be the only director who really was interested in doing political films. And he'd already made JFK, so, you know, but I had a lot of other ideas that I had discussed with him of things that we could do. And one of the things I have observed is that there's a sort of a mutual fascination between Washington and Hollywood, because each wants what the other has. Hollywood has the glamour, of course, and the money. You see politicians coming out here all the time for fundraisers, and, you know, this is where they raise a lot of their money due to the crazy system that we have of campaign finance. But they also want some of the glamour to rub off on them. And the Hollywood people want what Washington has, which is, first of all, power, of course. And secondly, their respect. You know, Hollywood, a lot of times people sort of make fun of Hollywood actors. Like, I just heard somebody, I think, on Fox News the other day saying, I saw there was an article about Sean Penn was over in Iraq. And they were like, what does Sean Penn know about Iraq? This guy's an idiot, you know. He has no business. And I felt like, you know, he knows, at least he took the time and trouble to go there and see it, you know, which is more than this right-wing commentator did. And Sean Penn's comments were actually very measured. I think he was very well aware of what happened to Jane Fonda after she went to Vietnam. And so he, you know, I thought what he said was sensible, but, you know, but Hollywood people, there's a fascination out there in the country with Hollywood. There's no doubt about it. And Hollywood people have a certain influence, rightly or wrongly. And it's used, you know, by Washington people. Senators and congressmen like to, you know, have celebrities come and hold a hearing and, you know, have Michael J. Fox talk about Parkinson's disease, or Jessica Lange talk about farm issues, or whatever it may be. you know, because that attracts cameras. And so it works both ways. And there's also sort of a convergence. Politics has become more and more showbiz. I mean, you have to be slick and polished and have the 30-second ads. And, you know, there's the constant cable TV shows. And, you know, you make one misstep. Look what happened to Trent Lott. I mean, even I couldn't believe it. The guy, you know, he's at a 100th birthday party for Strom Thurmond. He makes one off-the-cuff remark, and it just snowballs or into this firestorm of controversy. He's probably going to lose his job over it. And so, you know, you have to be a kind of a an actor. I mean, of course, the ultimate was Ronald Reagan, who was just, you know, a B-grade Hollywood actor who became president, but he knew how to stick to a script, how to deliver his lines, and a lot of them came straight out of the movies. And, you know, like, make my day, you know. I mean, he literally said that, and it worked for him, you know, and he became the model. Now George W. is trying to do the same thing. He's not as good of an actor. He doesn't have the training that Reagan had, but... Yeah, but, you know, but he tries, and I think also Hollywood, in a way, has become more political. You see shows like The West Wing, which is very popular, you know, as entertainment. You see movies like Air Force One or 13 Days or Wag the Dog or JFK or, you know... shows like Spin City. I mean, it's considered good material. And so it works in both directions. And another point which is often raised is, you know, that kids are learning all their history from the movies. Like, people always ask me, well, you know, isn't it bad that, you know, if you make movies like JFK or Nixon, that this is what kids are going to believe. That's all they're going to know. And my response is always, well, you know, don't they teach history anymore? You know, don't people read books anymore? I mean, whatever happened to studying history in college or high school? I mean, don't, you know, they should be reading about JFK and Nixon, and hopefully those movies would spark that. I mean, if they're not being taught it in school, then maybe it's a good thing that the movies are being made. So otherwise, they wouldn't know anything. So, you know, I don't buy that argument. I think I did learn a few lessons in, and I can go into more detail about this, but, you know, Oliver Stone, I think, is sort of a mad genius. He's a brilliant guy, but he's also is pretty crazy in a way, and I think that could be a product of a lot of things. Obviously, he was in Vietnam, and, you know, but I think the Hollywood culture has kind of corrupted him, and he was arrested not too long ago for drugs and alcohol, which are, you know, not limited to Hollywood, but somehow you can get away with it. I think when you get to that level, you think you can do anything, you can get away with it. And I think Oliver, one of the writers of Nixon, said he's like a bowling ball that just sort of goes through life and knocks down everything in its path. And that his philosophy is that you kind of, you have to be brutal and tough and ruthless to succeed. And you have to step on people and crush them and do whatever it takes. And I just, in order to be successful, to get to the top, I don't buy that, you know. When you look at John Kerry or Lee Hamilton, these are very decent people. Kerry was also in Vietnam. He saw just as much combat as Oliver did. But yet, he's not a maniac. He doesn't abuse people. You know, he's trying to make this country a better place, but also, you know, to treat people in a decent way. And Lee Hamilton is the same. And so, you know, I don't buy into that kind of you know, Darwinian philosophy that Oliver has. And I think another thing I personally learned out of this whole experience was just the idea that, you know, if you have some kind of a dream or a wild idea or, you know, something that you want to do but you think it could never happen, you know, it can happen if you just sort of, you know, go about it and try to make it happen. I mean, I never, as I say, I always loved film. I always was interested in arts and literature and politics, but I never envisioned coming to Hollywood. But I sort of got this idea in the back of my mind as we were going along, you know, with JFK, that, you know, well, maybe, you know, when I saw the response to it and the power that the film had and the way that it changed public opinion and turned the Congress around and the way that it reached people and moved them, that I thought, you know, this medium is really powerful and that, you know, I'd like to, you know, try to do something with it. And so I just wrote him a letter. I'm a great believer in sort of old-fashioned snail mail. You know, I just wrote him a letter. This is before the days of email anyway, but, you know, I didn't even have his address, you know. I sent it to a friend who knew him, and I didn't even know if it would reach him, and it did. And then he invited me to come out and have dinner with him, and I did that, and one thing led to another, and I ended up working for him. And then I had an idea. We had talked about maybe doing a movie about Stalin or Hitler or Mao. And so I started thinking, well, you know, who do we have in America who's not on that level of evil, but just sort of, you know, in any way comparable? And I came up with Nixon, and I had always been a Watergate junkie myself. And so I had this idea. I happened to have lunch with a writer named Steve Revell, who I had wanted to meet, and I'd read some of his stuff, and he was kind of unknown at the time, but he liked the idea, and he wanted to write something, and he had a partner, Chris Wilkinson, and the two of them I said, you know, write it, you know, write a treatment. So they wrote like a 3-page treatment. I gave it to Oliver, and he said, let's hire these guys. And they wrote a script, and there's an expression, the movie gods, and the movie gods were sort of shining on us, and, you know, everything fell into place, and it happened. I mean, there were a number of other movies that he wanted to make. There was one about Noriega, one about Evita, and somehow all those projects fell apart, and then Nixon came together, and it just happened. And so I decided at that point I would start keeping a diary and a journal, and that was sort of the basis of this book. That was very helpful to me when I wrote the book, because when I went back and, you know, I realized how much I'd forgotten, I thought, thank God I wrote it down. But so I would say, you know, and people have actually written me letters since the book came out saying, you know, your book has inspired me to, you know, see what I can do with my own life or in my own, you know, town of Newark, New Jersey, or, you know, whatever it might be. And, you know, I mean, it doesn't apply just to JFK freaks or, you know, conspiracy nuts. I mean, you know, a lot of people told me that I couldn't even get a job as a lawyer, you know, that, and then, you know, that it would be impossible to get a job with a senator. And then, you know, I thought people were going to tell me I was crazy when I didn't even, you know, tell anybody that I had asked Oliver Stone for a job, but everybody in Washington that I knew was very supportive and was very excited about it. And, you know, and then things eventually, you know, got to, and then, you know, to be able to make the movie Nixon, to actually get a movie made in Hollywood, any movie, is very difficult. But I produced that with him. Then I produced another movie with him called Any Given Sunday, which was about pro football, which was another idea that I had, which sort of, in a strange way, flowed out of Nixon, out of a letter that someone wrote us. But so, you know, all of these things. And then eventually Oliver just got a little too crazy for me, and he had some kind of sleazy people around him, one in particular who I refer to in the book as Danny the Weasel. And if you read the book, you can learn more about him. And he changed his name, but it's in there. But he's an example of a modern-day Sammy Glick. In fact, there's a couple of quotes I want to read you, but I would just say, you know, it got to the point where I felt that I had to leave. And so I left Oliver's office, and then I subsequently went on to write a script for him and about Chairman Mao, and then I wrote a script with John Dean about the Pentagon Papers, and wrote several other scripts, and some of them sold and some didn't. But, you know, then I sort of got tired of being in development hell, and so I thought, well, I'll write a book. And, you know, and miraculously, without even having a literary agent, I was able to get it published. So, you know, I think it just tells me that, you know, if you want to do something, you can do it, you know. But I would also caution, you know, another thing I learned from Oliver is be careful what you wish for, because you may get it, and then you have to live with the consequences. I talk in my book about what I call the Oliver Zone, and I'll just read a little excerpt. I wrote, "I had long ago realized that it was impossible to figure out Oliver's motives because he simply did not act rationally. He lived in what I called the Oliver Zone, or for short, the O-Zone. The Oliver Zone was like a weird antimatter, anti-gravity, magnetic force field that warped the reality around it. Usually events in the real world happen in a somewhat normal, predictable manner most of the time. But when you were around Oliver, these rules were suspended. Strange things would happen, and you often felt like you were the one who was on drugs, not him. I can't explain this phenomenon, but I experienced it many times. Time seemed to move either faster or slower than normal, and people around him seemed to act in abnormal and sometimes surreal fashion." And I think that's not limited to Oliver. I think a number of Hollywood celebrities maybe engender this phenomenon, but I think he combines genius and madness. I compare him to Picasso. In fact, if you have seen the movie Surviving Picasso, which Anthony Hopkins did right after he did Nixon, he basically he played Oliver. I saw so many of Oliver's mannerisms in the way that he portrayed Picasso. It was amazing to me, you know. And if you've ever seen some of Picasso's pictures of, like, I think he calls them minotaurs, sort of half man, half beast. That's kind of how I look at Oliver. You know, he's sort of like this mad, you know, half man, half beast. But I do give him great credit, not only for the movies that he's made, but for the influence that they've had, JFK being one of them. I don't agree with all of his theories in JFK, but I do think that it shows the power of film and the power that an idea can have. If you read my book, you can also, there's an appendix which will give you the solution to who killed Kennedy and how it was done, and names all the people involved, but you have to buy the book to get that. So, and I also want to just mention in closing that there's a very good movie that a young lady who's here, Azita Zendel, has done, which is a fictionalized version of Oliver and his zone. It's called Controlled Chaos, and it's being shown in Sundance and other places, and I hope it'll get picked up and distributed. And you know, that will sort of take you into the Oliver zone. So anyway, with that, maybe I'll stop. I have a few more passages I can read to you, but I prefer to actually, if anybody has any questions or comments, to go to that and you know, just try to respond, or I'm interested. I've done a lot of radio shows, and I've heard a lot of really weird, strange questions. So you can throw anything at me. So okay, Sarita.
Yeah, Eric. Okay, I concur with your hypotheses that the Hollywood and versus the Washington attraction. Given that the Democrats had so much of the Hollywood support during the 2000 election, it didn't seem to propel their presidential candidate forward. In fact, I don't know if it really helped at all. Since we were, Carol and I were both in Florida, and we saw a slew of Hollywood stars, but that didn't help us there.
Yeah, well, unfortunately, you know, if Supreme Court justices were picked on the basis of box office, you know, then Gore probably would have won the election because we would have had more Democrats on the Supreme Court. And, I mean, I regard that election as just a judicial coup d'etat. I mean, let's face it, Gore won. He got 500,000 more votes. And, you know, Gore is not a particularly swinging Hollywood guy. I mean, he's not JFK. He's not Ronald Reagan. You know, he's not charismatic, to say the least. But nevertheless, he won, and he certainly did have Hollywood people like Rob Reiner that were strongly supporting him. But, you know, I mean, Hollywood can only do so much, you know. I mean, they can't influence the votes of the United States Supreme Court. And so I think, you know, that was sort of, I don't know, that just, to me, it was like something that you would see in a movie, but you would say this could never happen. But it, unfortunately, it happened. Any other, Leonard?
Eric, your book is a masterpiece in documenting people, time, places, events. You must have literally lived with a note taker in your pocket or under your pillow. How did you accomplish all of this? Certainly not from memory.
Well, no, as I said, I mean, I had a couple of good friends, Michael and Ann Mandelbaum in Washington, who had urged me. I mean, all of my friends in Washington were sort of like, you know, I can't believe you're doing this, but, you know, it's really great. And I thought people were going to tell me you're out of your mind. But they said to me, you know, you should really keep a diary. You know, this is an amazing experience. And I was like, I don't know, you know, I don't know if I want to keep a diary. But then after I realized, and Oliver never told me I'm going to make Nixon, because he's very secretive, I just sort of had to figure it out, you know, after I saw him reading the Haldeman diaries and things like that, I realized, wait a minute, he's actually going to make this movie, you know. So I started, I'm also an inveterate memo writer, so I have files from day one of all the memos that I wrote to him. So that was material that I could draw on. And I found that that was a good way to deal with him. I mean, I had done a lot of that in Washington, but particularly with Oliver, it was much better to write something out in a memo, preferably a page or, you know, or so, because he didn't like to read long memos, but write it out, because then he could take it home, he could read it at his leisure, he could think about it, and then when he wanted to, you know, he could say, you know, he could call you up, or he could call you into his office and you could discuss it with him. If you were to just walk in there cold, you know, and propose some wild idea, you don't know what substance he might be on, you know, what mood he would be in. I mean, or what, you know, anything could be going through his head. And so, I mean, you could just get rejected out of hand. So, you know, so I developed the habit of writing these memos. And then on top of that, I started keeping a journal, and I kept it throughout the making of Nixon. Not necessarily with the idea of writing a book, but just thinking, well, you know, this is a very interesting, unique experience, and I'll just sort of document the making of a movie of Nixon. And then once it was finished and it was out there, and, you know, we had all the reviews and the box office and everything was done, then I kind of tapered off, and eventually I stopped keeping the diary. But, you know, and then when I left his office, I left with kind of a sour taste, and I just didn't even want to think about it. So I stuck them away. And then a couple of years later, when he was arrested for drunk driving and possession of hashish and some hard drugs and a few other things, then I sort of felt vindicated in my view of him, because I tend to blame myself if something goes wrong. But I realized, you know, I really was dealing with a guy who was a little crazy and out of his mind. And so I thought, well, I'll dig out these diaries. Then, of course, I couldn't find them. I mean, it just was a nightmare. But eventually they turned up. And so I started writing it as a diary. I mean, my original thought was this would just be the diary of the making of a movie. But then I realized you had to sort of preface it with, you know, how I got to that point. And then you had to kind of fill in the spaces in between, you know, in the journal. And then you had to say what happened afterwards. And so I kind of just, I wrote up the whole thing and then submitted it to a few publishers. And one of them, luckily, Public Affairs, liked the idea, but they wanted me to rewrite it as a narrative. But I was amazed, as I mentioned in the book, which is called JFK, Nixon, Oliver Stone, and Me, that, you know, there were so many things that I had forgotten, and that it really, you know, thank God I had those notebooks, because so much of it came back to me. And there were certain key incidents and anecdotes that stick in your mind, and, you know, that I think I have a pretty good memory, and so I did draw on those, but it does help, definitely, to take notes. I learned that a little. I should have learned that in law school, but at least later than better late than never. Yes.
One of the things that you talk about several times in the book is how incredibly secretive Stone would be about anything that he was working on, even with his closest business associates. He absolutely did not want any copies of the script around and would kind of hoard them up. I'm wondering if you ever even just kind of nudgingly and humorously told him, geez, Stone, you're kind of acting like one of those people who keep all the JFK files so secretive, you know, or if he ever had any sense of irony or humor about that, or, you know, his own penchant for secrecy and kind of paranoia.
Well, he doesn't have much of a sense of humor to begin with, you know, and certainly not with regard to himself. And I don't know where this penchant for secrecy, I mean, I didn't really put it to him in those terms. I mean, one of the things that I mentioned in the book is that, you never knew how he would react, you know, to something. But you could sometimes see it coming, you know. You could see him sort of losing it, and smoke would start coming out of his ears, and you could see that his, you know, head was about to explode, and the best thing to do was just, you know, run as fast as you could in the other direction. But he had a very strange habit, you know. He liked to create competition. I mean, maybe to a certain extent that is, you know, conducive to creativity or can be helpful in some way, but he would refer to people as his satellites, and each person had sort of their own orbit and their own role, and you know and it was very hard to get out of that. And also he liked setting people against each other and creating conflicts. And the way it manifested itself was that he would have two companies side by side at the same time, which made no sense. I mean, to have one company, he had a company called Ixlan. That was his primary company when I came there. And they were funded by another company called New Regency, which in turn was funded by Warner Brothers. And we had nice offices in Santa Monica. And, you know, they gave us a development fund so that we could pay writers to write scripts, or we could option books or whatever it might be, and pay people salaries and little things like that. And, you know, so, you know, that was all fine. But then he had another company alongside it called JD Productions that was making Natural Born Killers. And so, you know, there was this great aura of secrecy, and they were also trying to develop other projects so that they could stay on and work with Oliver. And he showed them no loyalty at all. I mean, even though Natural Born Killers financially was a relative success for him, it was sort of a comeback after Heaven and Earth, which was a complete flop. But he kicked them out as soon as, I mean, it was in their contract that he had a right to do this, but he kicked them out as soon as the movie was released. And then he brought in this other guy who I call Danny the Weasel, who was this sort of Sammy Glick figure, and he set up a company called Illusion Entertainment, and that existed alongside Ixlan, and sometimes they would compete for the same projects, and it just didn't make any sense. And you know, and that Ixlan at least was sort of a creative environment, and they were trying to make artistic films, and you know, Illusion was just purely commercial and was a big flop. It was meant to, you know, just make big budget commercial movies and make a lot of money, and instead it lost a lot of money and made, you know, lousy movies. But one of the things, I read an article, I never understood why did Oliver, he brought in this guy who was a nobody in Hollywood. He was like, I compare him to Dan Quayle. I mean, he was just a complete airhead. And I couldn't understand why he had done this. And even Oliver used to refer to him as a spineless weasel. That's where I gave him that name. But I read an article in the New York Times about the book What Makes Sammy Run, which was written in about the 30s and is now, I think, finally being made into a movie. And it quoted the author. Let me just read you a little bit. It says, Bud Schulberg wrote a classic novel in the 1930s called What Makes Sammy Run, about a character named Sammy Glick, who was an aspiring Hollywood mogul. He described him as, quote, a little ferret of a kid, sharp and quick. In the midst of a war that was selfish, ruthless, and cruel, Sammy was proving himself the fittest, the fiercest, and the cruelest. It was meant to be a cautionary tale. Back then, Sammy Glick was the villain of the piece, an awful example of what might happen if you let individualism and free enterprise run away with you. But then something happened in the collective American psyche. In the 1970s, Schulberg noted a 180-degree turn in our national attitude towards Sammy. In a 1989 edition, Schulberg added, as an afterword, the book I had written as an angry expose of Sammy Glick had become a character reference. One student told him of his admiration for Glick. He put out his hand, the hand that would soon be knifing friends and colleagues in the back, Schulberg wrote. As I took it hesitantly, I asked myself, what have I done? And, you know, I have a feeling that guy might have actually been Danny the Weasel. I don't know. I sort of, but, you know, but I just, he's just an example. There are a lot of that type of person, whether they're agents or producers or whatever they may be, studio executives. And, you know, what can you say? You know, I mean, that's Hollywood, you know. I mean, not that there aren't, you know, tough and ruthless people in Washington, but you can get away with more outrageous behavior in Hollywood, definitely, than you can. I mean, in Hollywood, I mean, can you imagine that this country was tied up for 2 years or so on the Monica Lewinsky scandal? That would have been a one-day story in Hollywood, you know, and then it'd be over. I mean, who cares, you know? But it's just, it's a different environment. Yes, in the back.
Did you have any discussions with Oliver Stone concerning the vehemence with which Jack Valenti attacked the film JFK?
Yeah, we did kind of joke about Valenti, and they later sort of made up. I mean, Valenti, for those of you who don't know, had been an aide to Lyndon Johnson. And then he's now like 80 years old, but he's the head of the Motion Picture Association of America. And he's the chief lobbyist for Hollywood in Washington, and he has a lot of power. And he absolutely hated the movie JFK because he interpreted it, maybe rightly, maybe not, as blaming Lyndon Johnson for the assassination. And, you know, and that just infuriated him because he owed everything, his career, his life, to LBJ. He worshipped JFK, or LBJ, rather. And so he, you know, he refrained from attacking the movie until after it had been released and after it had made its money, because, you know, the Warner Brothers people leaned on him. But then he came out with these virulent attacks, and he wasn't the only one. I mean, the New York Times practically every day was running some attack. I mean, but, you know, Oliver sort of, he produced a TV sort of miniseries called Wild Palms, where he did kind of a takeoff on Valenti. And, you know, he, you know, they sort of made up, but I think they just both think that each other is a complete wacko. And, you know, it's what I disagree with in JFK is that Oliver is obsessed with Vietnam, and he's made some great movies about Vietnam, but he thinks that the assassination of JFK was all about Vietnam. You know, of course, this is all goes back to the fact that Oliver served in Vietnam himself and is obsessed with it. And so he thinks it was all a plot to, you know, get us into Vietnam, and then it was the Pentagon and the military-industrial complex, and, you know, that I think Garrison in the movie said it was a coup d'etat with Lyndon Johnson waiting in the wings. And I don't think it had anything to do with Vietnam. It's true that Vietnam happened later, but, you know, I think Kennedy would have pulled out. I don't think he would have done at all what Johnson did. But I think it had much more to do with Cuba and with the CIA mafia plots against Castro and how that got turned around, or as we put it in Nixon, it turned into a Frankenstein monster that ended up killing Kennedy. And I don't think, I mean, I'll give you one example. Somebody told me the other day that they had heard that Johnson was in the White House, and when Kennedy killed, that Johnson, you know, got a phone call that said, "It's done." you know, and that this supposedly had been in the movie but had been cut out or something. But that's just not true. Johnson was in the motorcade with Kennedy. And personally, if I were LBJ and I knew that there were going to be shots flying from two or three directions, you know, I wouldn't ride around in an open car in a motorcade. You know, I wouldn't go anywhere near there. You know, so for that reason alone, I don't think that LBJ was behind it. Conversely, I don't think that Lee Harvey Oswald acted alone, because if for no other reason than he had a lousy World War I Mannlicher Carcano rifle that had a misaligned scope or sight, and he was a lousy shot, and nobody, even the most skilled marksman, has ever been able to reproduce what he supposedly did. And there's a great scene in JFK where one of Garrison's guys, they're in the, I've been there myself, to the book depository, and the guy says, "This is the whole case to me, Chief. The guy just could not do the shooting from that bookstore." You know, it's that simple. And, you know, in addition to that, there's a lot of evidence that there was another shot that came from the picket fence, you know, on the so-called grassy knoll. And, I mean, you could go into it ad infinitum, but, you know, but I think Oliver was right about one big thing, which was that there was a conspiracy. And the polls had shown for many years, way before his movie, that at least 2/3 of the public always believed there was a conspiracy. They never believed the Warren Commission. But I don't think that he was right in, you know, his interpretation. Yes.
Do you still feel that making political movies or any kind of movies, do you still feel after having had these experiences that you can make movies that will make some kind of difference?
Yeah, I mean, I think, I don't know, I have a mixed feeling. I remember one time seeing one of these tribute shows or something, and it was, I don't know, one of these like American Film Institute tribute to Tom Hanks or something, and it was about the time that Forrest Gump came out, and Barbara Streisand got up and said, "Tom, I just want to thank you. I love your movie, that, you know, the way that it affirms the human spirit." And I felt like throwing up. I just thought, this is what makes me sick about Hollywood, is this kind of nonsense, you know. And that was the most reactionary movie. And, you know, why anybody likes Tom Hanks is beyond me. But I don't know. I hope he's watching, you know. But anyway, so, you know, there's certain people who just, you know, are just interested in how big their gross can be, you know. And those are usually the biggest stars, and they have the biggest grosses. But I think, yeah, a movie, you know, can touch you, can move you. I read an article today about a movie coming out called Max, which is about the young Hitler, you know, when he was still a painter in Austria. And it's just touched off this incredible, it hasn't even been released, but just the people that have seen it, this incredible reaction. And, you know, I think, and a movie doesn't have to be overtly political. You know, I saw the movie Frida the other day, you know, about Frida Kahlo, the artist, which is not, you know, it's not JFK, but it's a very interesting and moving film. And, you know, I think anything that's honest and sincere, you know, whether it's a documentary, I think documentaries are greatly underrated. There ought to be a lot. There should be a documentary channel. I don't understand why, you know, it's so hard to get documentaries shown on the air. They ought to just have one whole channel that just showed them around the clock. But, you know, it is very hard to get political movies made. There's sort of a stigma to it, you know, that goes way back. Sam Goldwyn or whoever said, you know, if you want to send a message, use Western Union. But, you know, and it's also a matter of movies are made basically for 14-year-old teenage boys, you know, or else 14-year-old teenage girls. You know, that's sort of the core audience that go to the malls. And the reason Titanic made $1 billion is because it appealed to those audiences and those kids who went to see it 18 times or whatever. And because you can't make that much money on just, you know, unless you have repeat viewings. So, you know, you're appealing to a lowbrow mentality. But on the other hand, you know, and you know, I hate to see the amount of money that's wasted in Hollywood. There's just so much waste. I mean, it's almost as bad as the military. But on the other hand, there's great films, you know, independent films being made, foreign films. There's great films coming out of Iran and Mexico and places like that. That, you know, if you can find them, they're usually playing in some small art theater. But, you know, yeah, I think movies can make a difference. But sometimes I wonder if it's worth it, the effort that it takes to do it. But, you know, for some reason, there's always crazy people out there who want to do it. And they keep doing it. Yeah, Susie.
Now we're talking about making a movie. Are you planning to make a movie out of this book?
I don't think so. As I said, I think Azita's movie sort of covers this territory. Not exactly, but it's similar. And I think, I mean, you never know. Some weird things have been done, like Being John Malkovich, you know, which was a movie about going inside the head of John Malkovich, the actor. I read the script when I was working for Oliver, and I thought, this is brilliant, but this will never get made in a million years, you know, and it got made. And now the guy, I haven't seen it yet, but I'm looking forward. He's written a book called Adaptation, which, you know, it's a screenwriter named Charlie Kaufman, and which is about his own process of trying to adapt a novel, and you know, he brings himself into it and this mythical twin brother, and you know, sort of takes real characters and puts them on drugs and doing all these crazy things. And I don't know, the strangest things get made into movies, you know. So if there's anybody out there that's interested, this is the book. You can, you know, option it, and I'll be happy to talk to you. But I have no plans to do that. David.
Speaking of movies, what projects are you working on now that you can share with us?
Well, I mentioned the Pentagon Papers. What happened there was that on Nixon, one thing I'll give to Oliver is that he does really extensive research for his movies. Rightly or wrongly, I mean, he may get the big things wrong, but he gets the little things right. You know, what a Coke bottle looked like in 1963 or whatever, you know. And but I mean, when we made Nixon, we went to Washington, we met with, you know, everybody from Ron Ziegler and Elliot Richardson and all kinds of people, to Dan Shore, people who had known Nixon, who had worked with him, Len Garment. And we hired John Dean as a consultant, and then he became a friend of mine. And he was a great help on the movie. And so we decided to write a script together about the Pentagon Papers case, which he had been involved in at the time. And without going into the details of it, it involved a leak of government secrets and Vietnam and so forth. And it's a very interesting story and had never been told on film, but this is a classic example of development hell. I mean, we wrote this script and we went around and we met with the head of a big, powerful agency, and he said, I'm going to get this made by next spring, and, you know, blah, 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 and it never happened. And then we met with Coppola's people, but, you know, somehow, you know, we never met with Coppola. And anyway, eventually, through a friend of mine, we got it to Alec Baldwin, who is a sort of, you know, political actor and, you know, is very oriented towards the First Amendment and free speech. And he actually read it and liked it. And so we took it, he took it to a cable network. And so then they, of course, immediately wanted to bring in another writer. He wanted to bring in a writer that he'd worked with on another project. And then they had a deal with the late director, John Frankenheimer, who made The Manchurian Candidate and some other movies. And, you know, it was very well respected. And Frankenheimer had his writer that he wanted. So they hired his writer to rewrite it. And they also wanted to expand it into a miniseries. And so his writer, you know, took so long. He wrote two drafts, both of which were rejected by the studio. And then, you know, he was fired. And then Frankenheimer passed away. I mean, this the whole thing took so long that he literally died. And then they went back to Alec Baldwin's writer. And then we never heard anything. We never saw any script. And, you know, and finally John Dean ran into him in a car wash and said, "What happened?" You know, and he said, "Oh, they told me to stop writing 6 months ago." And meanwhile, they had renewed our option. I mean, because 18 months had gone by, so they renewed it for another 18 months. And then, you know, so we asked our agent, you know, what the heck is going on? And so, you know, we don't really know. You know, it's in limbo. It's in development hell. And meanwhile, another cable network stole the idea and had somebody write up a quickie script because it's in the public domain. It's history, you know, and they're supposedly going to make it. So I don't know what's going to happen with the Pentagon Papers. You know, it's just, I mean, that was one of the more, you know, frustrating, because we could have rewritten it. We were both worked very fast and we worked well together. We could have rewritten it six times, you know, in the time that they wasted. But some writers, the guys who wrote Nixon, who were complete, I mean, they were very good writers, but complete nobodies in Hollywood. They didn't even have an agent when I discovered them. And then their script was so good, it was nominated for an Academy Award. And then they got, you know, they got an agent, they got into the million-dollar club of screenwriters, and they made a ton of money writing scripts, most of which, you know, they write and rewrite and rewrite. I mean, the studio pays them, and the movies don't get made. And finally, they got a movie made last year, Ali, which their script was excellent, but then what happened was the director came in and he rewrote it with his writer. So it was a weird thing. I called to congratulate them, but yet they were unhappy about the way the movie had turned out. And so, you know, it was just a strange situation. But I mean, there was enough of their script still in there that it was still a good movie. And you know, and they felt good about just getting it made. I don't care what it is, you know, to get anything made is an accomplishment. To get a good movie made is really difficult. But one thing that I would say, and I've said this in this book, there was a lot of controversy about Nixon, the movie, which surprised me, because I didn't think it was that controversial. It wasn't a conspiracy theory. As John Dean put it, it was more of a portrait than a photograph. We were trying to sort of get inside the psyche of the man, and we went back to his childhood, and we went and visited his boyhood home, and all sorts of things. And, you know, but it was sort of all the people who had hated JFK sort of vented their rage on the movie Nixon. And I've often said, if the exact same movie had been made by Francis Ford Coppola or Martin Scorsese, we wouldn't have had all the controversy. But I would also say that that movie, I mean, you know, there's such a thing as a director's credit, and you always see, you know, a film by Oliver Stone or an Oliver Stone film. That just as much of the credit for that movie belongs to those two writers and to Anthony Hopkins, who admittedly Oliver picked. You know, he hired the writers, he hired Anthony Hopkins. Hopkins agreed to do it. But you could just as well call it a film, an Anthony Hopkins film, or a Ravel Wilkinson film, as an Oliver Stone film. And actors, of course, are well paid and get a lot of recognition. Writers get none or very little, and, you know, they can make a lot of money if they're, you know, successful, but they can still, you know, they're just considered the low man on the totem pole. And I don't know if I should say this, but there's a story, I can't say it right, but a joke about the Polish starlet who was so dumb that she slept with the writer or something like that. Because writers have no power, you know. They can't cast you. They can't get you into the movie, you know. I mean, but yet, to me, you know, the script is the whole movie. It's like the actors and even the director are secondary. It's all in the writing. So that's my soapbox lecture. Yes.
You talked about the JFK and CIA and mob and Castro. You think it's a theory that JFK wanted to kill Castro and mob and CIA didn't want Castro to die, so stopped it by assassinating Kennedy?
Well, I wouldn't put it exactly that way. I think what happened was that, and this is well documented and is not even controversial, is that the CIA basically hired the mafia to kill Castro. They wanted him, and this was back in the late 50s, shortly after he took power. They saw that Nixon met with him just a few months after he took power and wrote a famous memo, and he said, either this guy is extremely naive and crazy, or else he's a communist. And either way, we need to get rid of him. And then Nixon became head of the Cuba task force. And so they set up this whole operation, and they brought in the mafia because, you know, if you want somebody bumped off, who do you hire? You go to the mafia. And so there were several factors at work. You know, the mafia didn't like Castro because he had taken away their casinos and shut down the gambling. And a lot of the anti-Castro Cubans, he'd taken their property and they wanted it back and their factories and so on. And the CIA wanted him killed. And so, you know, they made numerous attempts. They tried to kill him with a poisoned milkshake and an exploding cigar and, you know, a seashell that was supposed to explode when he was skin diving or something, and all these crazy schemes that never worked. And what I think happened is that some, what you might call rogue elements of the, I think Kennedy, first of all, he inherited these plans from Eisenhower, and I think he had a big, he turned very much against the CIA after the Bay of Pigs invasion, which was a total fiasco that, you know, occurred shortly after he took office, but had been planned under Eisenhower and Nixon. And he said, I'm going to smash the CIA into 1,000 pieces. And he fired all the top people there, or most of them, and who had planned this fiasco. And then secondly, there was the Cuban Missile Crisis. And I think he realized at that point how close, you know, how dangerous it was to be in this state of confrontation with Cuba and how close we'd come to nuclear war. And at that point, he was making behind-the-scenes efforts to have a rapprochement with Castro. And he was also shutting down the training camps and the anti-Castro activities, And so I think those people basically turned against him and decided, you know, it's easier to kill Kennedy than it would be to kill Castro. And I think that there are certain people whose names I do name in the book who were involved. And I think that they were going to get him one way or another. I think the original plan was actually to kill him a few days earlier in Miami, but his people got wind of it and canceled that appearance. And then he was killed in Dallas. If it hadn't been, there was also a plot in Chicago. There was another one in Los Angeles. You know, they were going to get him one way or the other. And, you know, and of course he was a fatalist. He didn't take precautions. He was riding around in an open car. You know, he had brushes with death. His brother had been killed in the war. And his attitude was, if somebody wants to kill a president, you know, they can do it. And they did it. I mean, that's the way I see it. Any other questions? Yes.
Do you think, in view of what you just said, that had he taken precautions, that it still would have happened?
Well, that's hard to say. You know, I mean, the what ifs of history are very interesting, but I think that he was. If he had taken greater physical precautions, certainly that would have helped. But, you know, there were, I mean, J. Edgar Hoover hated him. Hoover did not inform him of any of these plots, which he knew about. Certain people in the CIA, not all of them, I don't think the head of the CIA knew anything about it, but people at a lower level were certainly involved. You know, and the mafia hated him because he was basically, and Bobby, because he was going after the mafia, trying to shut them down. And the Cubans are just in a class of their own, you know, they're just fanatics. So, I mean, these are the same people who, you know, kidnapped Elian Gonzalez. They're the same people who stormed the Democratic voting place in Miami and prevented them from counting the votes. So, I mean, they are still powerful. Some of them are still alive and living in Miami. This, to me, there was a book called Case Closed, you know, which was basically a rewrite of the Warren Commission. Nothing could be further from the truth. This case is wide open. I mean, many of the people involved are still living. And some of them have recently died. And of course, as time goes by, more and more of them die. But conversely, more and more information has come out. But these Miami Cubans, you know, are a dangerous bunch. And one of the interesting sidebars, Bill Clinton made a comment when he was criticized about the Mark Rich pardon. And he said, "I'm not going to talk about Mark Rich until George Bush talks about Orlando Bosch, who was a Cuban terrorist that was pardoned by President Bush Sr. and still lives happily in Miami, and who blew up a Cuban airliner and killed 73 people and committed numerous other terrorist acts." And Jeb Bush was very much involved in the campaign to get him released. And you know, the Bushes have always been very closely tied in with these people. George W. owes his presidency to these people. So there's no way that things are going to get any better, you know, until he's out of office. That's not to say that Fidel Castro was not a dictator, but he would like to improve relations. That's clear. That's why he invited Jimmy Carter to come down there. But Carter is not the president, unfortunately, any longer. But I am working on a script about Carter with his cooperation, just to go back to your question. I've also written a script about Gorbachev. But these are very hard sell. You know, sometimes an HBO or a cable network will make a movie like that. But they're considered for an older audience. the worst thing you can do is have a movie considered a history lesson, you know. So it's got to be dramatic, you know. If you can get some sex and drugs and dinosaurs in there, then, you know, maybe you can get it made. Yes.
You're talking a lot about scripts you've written that still deal with historical figures and politics. And I'm just curious if John Kerry, when 2004 rolls around, the primaries start, I mean, have you ever considered or thought about going back and working in politics, or either back to Washington or working in a presidential campaign from California?
Oh, absolutely. I'm already, you know, I've been in touch with Kerry. I saw him a few months ago at a fundraiser that I helped put together for him, and I'm in touch with people on his staff. And, you know, I'm going to work very hard to get John Kerry elected president, because, first of all, I think he's a great senator. I think he would make a great president. And second of all, I think this president has put us in a very dangerous situation. He doesn't know what he's doing. You know, he's created a situation in the Middle East that's like a big pool of oil that he's about to toss a match or a firecracker into. And, you know, who knows where it's going to lead us? You know, he just doesn't know what he's doing. He's not competent. He's not up to the job. And one of the things, for example, when you see a movie like 13 Days, you see it's not enough for a president to have good advisors around him, because Kennedy's advisors disagreed. Most of them were telling him he should invade Cuba, which probably would have set off a nuclear war. And, you know, only one or two had the guts to go against that. You know, there's sort of a groupthink that sets in. But Kennedy and Bobby and maybe one or two others, you know, decided let's try all the other options first. Let's try to reach a peaceful solution. But, you know, ultimately it's the guy at the top has to make the decisions. And with George W., you see a guy who has, you know, Cheney, Rumsfeld, you know, Wolfowitz, a bunch of hawks telling me he should invade Iraq, you know, as if, I mean, they had nothing to do with 9/11, but somehow that's going to distract people from the fact that we can't catch Osama bin Laden. And then on the other hand, you have relative moderates like Powell who are trying to find a peaceful solution. And, you know, basically Bush, every single promise that he made in the campaign, he has broken or reversed with regard to foreign policy. Remember, he said, we're going to be a humble nation. We're not going to engage in nation building. We're going to, you know, stay out of other people's affairs and respect, you know, their wishes. And, you know, on the contrary, I mean, he's just gone 180 degrees and said, you know, the United States is Godzilla and we're going to just stomp all over the world and crush anybody that we feel like. And if you don't like it, tough, you know. And so, you know, I think there's a good lesson to be learned there, you know, that you need somebody like John Kerry who has, you know, he's been in the Senate 17 years. He's sat on the Foreign Relations Committee all of that time. He's been on the Intelligence Committee. He knows a lot about foreign policy. He's been in war, unlike George W. He's seen combat. He's been wounded. And, you know, he's seen people killed. And he knows what war means. And I remember vividly something that Kerry always used to say in a lot of his speeches. And he would quote Edmund Burke. And he used to say, a wise man would be cautious how he dealt in blood. And that was what he learned from Vietnam. And unfortunately, I don't think our current president has learned that yet. Okay, we have time for maybe one more question, if anybody has one. Yes.
Do you think Harris will be able to rise above his bad press?
Well, I mean, any politician is going to get some bad press. There's no such thing as the perfect candidate. And, you know, the Republicans right now, I'm sure, are digging very hard for anything they can find on John Kerry. And if they can't find it, they'll make it up, just like they did about John McCain. You know, they were calling people in South Carolina and saying that he had an illegitimate black child and all this stuff that was complete lies. But, you know, I mean, I wouldn't put anything past these people. They're, you know, so many of them, ironically, got their start in the Nixon administration. Rumsfeld, Cheney, you know, I mean, these people are just sort of running plays out of Nixon's playbook. And but I think Kerry is prepared for that. He's a pretty tough guy. He's been through several statewide campaigns and, of course, has observed, you know, Massachusetts politics is pretty hardball stuff. And I think he's prepared for whatever they'll throw at him. And another advantage is he is married to Teresa Hines, and she is the heir to the Hines ketchup fortune. And, you know, they're prepared. They've said they don't want to use their own money, but if it gets nasty, they will. And if people start running attack ads and negative ads and things that are untrue, they're going to respond. And so, you know, I think he's going to be a formidable candidate. You know, I don't see anybody out there who's a stronger, maybe I'm biased, but, you know, without turning this into a political ad, I'll just conclude by saying John Kerry for president. Thank you. And I guess if anybody wants a book signed, I'll be happy to do that too. Kerry was a new senator. He had been head of the Vietnam Veterans Against the War. He'd served in Vietnam. He was already kind of nationally known, and his initials are JFK, and he sort of has that, you know, rugged presidential Massachusetts Democrat kind of look that, you know, I mean, he just is kind of a natural, and he's a very good speaker, but I sort of learned how to write speeches for him by doing it and learned about politics by being there. And one of the issues that I was assigned to work on was Vietnam veterans issues, and this was at a time when veterans were beginning to get more recognition. And that was actually how I first met Oliver Stone, was when he made Platoon. Kerry and I met with him in about 1987 at the Vietnam Veterans of America convention. Kerry was honored as Legislator of the Year, and Stone was being honored for Platoon. And so we met him, and I remember he was making Wall Street at that time, and he had just sort of become known through Platoon. That was his big breakthrough, and I think that was a great film. And so we talked about that, and at that time I had no idea, you know, whatsoever that I would ever end up in Hollywood, let alone working for Oliver Stone. But I did meet him, and so I worked for him for several years, and then basically he had been the lieutenant governor for Mike Dukakis and in Massachusetts, and so we were very involved in that campaign. And then when Dukakis lost, I decided to take some time out, and I went to Stanford for an academic year. I'd gotten... Thank you, Jen, and I want to thank Book Soup for having me here, and also C-SPAN for being here, and also I want to thank my publisher, Public Affairs Books, and all of my friends and relatives and everyone who has turned out here. It's very nice of you to come. So I've been given all sorts of conflicting advice about what I should say or do or how this is supposed to work and, you know, how many times I should try to plug my own book. But I think rather than do all that, I'll just sort of, I'd like to leave as much time as we can for question and answer or discussion, but I'll sort of start by making a few main points or giving you a little background on how this all came about. Basically, as the title implies, it's about several different things. Actually, my publisher came up with the title. It's sort of a pun. Obviously, JFK and Nixon are movies that were made by Oliver Stone, as well as being presidents of the United States. And the me refers to me. So I didn't actually know JFK or Nixon. I wish I had, but I did know Oliver Stone. And I'm not going to say I wish I hadn't. I'll say that it was a mixed blessing, but I'm glad I did. But it's a book about Washington and Hollywood, and it's unusual in the sense that, I mean, there are a number of people who have made that journey, but, not that many who have worked in both places, and I have done both, so to me, I just thought there's something wrong with this picture. First of all, they can't both be right, and how can something of this magnitude how can we not have the answer? This was, this is one of the major events of this century, and so what I concluded after reading a number of the books was that basically there were more theories than facts, and we just needed more facts. And then what happened was I went back to Washington on another fellowship, and I went to work for Lee Hamilton, who was then chairman of the Foreign Affairs Committee in the House and is now, just within the last few days, has become co-chairman of the commission to investigate the 9/11 terrorist incidents. And he is a very upstanding, or was, I mean, he's no longer in Congress, but respected member of Congress, and had been chairman of the Intelligence Committee and the Iran-Contra Committee. And he asked me to look into the whole problem of government secrecy and what we could do about it. And he felt that way too many documents are classified, too many security clearances, too much secrecy, and that, we should have more openness in government. And so I started researching it, and it was clear that that was true. I mean, just the other day, there was an article in the paper that said that the CIA is still refusing to release its budget from 1947 and 1948. So, I mean, if you can believe that. It's just, it's amazing, the level of secrecy. And, of course, it's only gotten worse under the current Bush administration. They have a fetish for secrecy. But I began to realize, I put two and two together in my mind, and I researched it and found out that we could, it's kind of a perspective on the two and how they intersect in different ways. And to sort of make a long story short, I started by working with Senator John Kerry on the Hill. I was always interested in politics, and I wanted to work for a Democratic senator. And I went to law school, and I tried practicing law for a few years, and that didn't really excite me. And so I moved to Washington from California, and I was lucky enough to get a job with Senator Kerry in 1985. He had just been elected, And as of now, as of just the last couple of days, the book is even timelier because, of course, Al Gore has dropped out of the race and Kerry is probably the leading candidate for president on the Democratic side. And I think he'll probably win, and I think he'll make a great president. But I worked for him for about 3 or 4 years. I was a speechwriter and a legislative assistant. And one of the things I've found, I mean, in life is sort of everybody is a critic, and there's certain things that everybody thinks they know all about. And one of them is politics, another one is movies, and now I'm finding out another one is books. And everybody sort of, you know, has their own opinion. But what I found, you know, when I went to Capitol Hill is there are many levels, many layers of politics that I wasn't aware of, and a lot of things that I had to learn, which was very interesting and stimulating experience to do. And I'm very interested in foreign policy issues, and I got a fellowship and I was studying there. But I also had this sort of strange obsession in the back of my mind with the JFK assassination. I guess what brought it to the fore was that right at that same point in time, this is end of 88, was the 25th anniversary of Kennedy's assassination. So there were a number, I remember seeing a TV special that Jack Anderson did about it, about the conspiracy theories, and there were some books that came out, and I had always sort of been vaguely aware of this and always been interested but never really pursued it. But, you know, I had this time out and I started reading. I bought some of these books and started reading them. It turned out Stone had bought some of the same books, and one of them, which was Jim Garrison's book, ended up being the basis for JFK. One of the things that I found out, which I think most people don't know, is that there are two official versions of the JFK assassination. One is the Warren Commission, which most people know about, which says that Lee Harvey Oswald, acting alone, shot Kennedy and that he was a lone nut. But then Congress reinvestigated the assassination in the late 70s due to all the questions that had arisen and the fact that it had come out that the CIA had plotted with the mafia to try to kill Castro. So they created what was called the House Committee on Assassinations, and they studied the Kennedy assassination. And they came to the conclusion that there was a conspiracy and that it involved the mafia. And so you have two conflicting official versions. And then that was never followed up. They sealed their files they had 850 boxes of files. They sealed them for 50 years. And, you know, nobody could get at them. And this Warren Commission had sealed their files for 75 years.